The first question I asked Sir Arthur in this his beautiful house was what, if anything, is typically English?
Well, I suppose typically English, we think of somebody very tremendously steadfast, honest, rather slow, but a man like my dear gardener, Mr. Barrow, who I would trust anywhere.
What is it that you admire about the country?
Well, I suppose two things. First, we've evolved very slowly, Christian people descended from many different warring races. We've learned gradually to tolerate each other and to tolerate other people. Well, the English are kindly people. I always think that remark that General Smuts made in 1940, when he was talking to his own people in South Africa as to what they were going to do. And he said, the time has come to choose our friends. I choose the people who fought against us 40 years ago, but when we were at their mercy, treated us as a Christian people. That, to me, is a tremendous tribute to England. The other, I suppose, because I've lived all my life in England, is the pictures of England, itself, its countryside that I love, so many places. I mean, every day, every time I come down to this West Country, which I've known all my life, and I come off the hills and I see, cupped in the hills, the spire of Salisbury Cathedral rising against its green and blue background.
You were brought up amongst kings, weren't you? I mean, you were born in a house on a royal estate in Sunderland.
Well, my father was an official of the secretariat of Edward VII when he was Prince of Wales, and then after he became king, and then he stayed on under George V for 51 years. But I didn't have anything to do with them myself. I mean, they would occasionally inquire after me.
But were you aware of the situation you were in?
I was very aware that I was living next door in a small Regency house to Buckingham Palace, and I was mad about soldiers. And of course, it was a marvellous time for anybody who was mad about soldiers. One of the most marvellous pieces of pageantry I've ever seen was the funeral procession of Edward VII, which I saw from the wall of Marlborough House, bottom of St. James's Street in the corner of Balmoral. And it was the last time that one heard not only the British Army, but the army, so the whole of the Empire, in their marvellous coloured uniforms before they went over to a drab khaki.
What do you think fired off your enthusiasm for history as a child?
Partly, I think, because both my father and my mother read very well. My father was interested in history, and he used to read history. My mother in poetry, and which I suppose would be my two great literary loves. But I think what meant most to me, certainly as a boy, were the bound volumes, which I've got all around me in this room, of the Illustrated London News. Enormously heavy. They go from 1842 right up to the Edwardian period. And little did I guess that many years later I would spend, I've now spent 44 years writing every week or every month for the Illustrated London News. But I'd lie on the floor with these great volumes in front of me, and I almost feel I was through the siege of Paris in 1870, that kind of thing, because it made such an impression on me.
And what later on do you think made you feel that history was not just something in the past, but something that was alive and real?
Oh, undoubtedly the Shackley manuscripts. I read history both at Harrow and Oxford, but I was a very idle boy at Harrow, though I came under a great history teacher just before he died and I left. And I read nothing but poetry when I was at Oxford, when I was demobilised after the war.
A romantic young man?
A rather romantic young man. Rather a silly romantic young man. But then, a year or two later, when I became engaged to and afterwards married a Cheshire girl, Sylvia Shackley, my first wife, in the library at Somerford, there was a secret door covered with the names of 18th-century books. And behind that door was the muniment room, which was a kind of historian's paradise. apart from seals and documents going back to the 12th century, hundreds and thousands of letters of the 16th, 17th and 18th century. And it was taking over those letters, I used to transcribe 30 or 40 every night for many years, that made me realize that the past was real. I saw these lives growing before me. It also made me meticulous and a scholar.
You know, Sir Arthur, you got into some trouble over your defense of Germany. What was that about?
I did go to Germany when I was a young man, after I was demobilized in the First World War. I went two Christmas holidays in 1921 and 1922. It's the only time I've ever lived like a millionaire, because the exchange was so favorable. But I saw the Germans, and all the best of the Germans, their country destroyed, their faith gone. And when Germany began to recover, I, who never went to the cinema, I who never went there until just before the war, I sympathized with them. I was quite wrong. It never occurred to me that a man who had fought and as a private soldier through that terrible war of endurance on both sides would deliberately plunge the world into war again 20 years after the last war. Looking back, I think Neville Chamberlain was perfectly right to try to avoid the tragedy of the Second World War. Mm. Where we were wrong was in having disarmed ourselves, and I have always been a tremendous believer in our being strong enough to defend ourselves. I think, as Harold Macmillan said the other day, it's a profound mistake to if you're a rich country, to denude yourself of offences. It's only putting temptation in other people's ways. Had we been strong, we could, I think, have avoided the Second World War. But as it was, once the Germans got the bit between their teeth, there was no possibility of doing so.
You think education is a top priority. What, as an ex-teacher, do you think it's important to teach a child?
To teach a child to concentrate, to become master of one thing. An educated man, to me, is a man who has mastered one craft. It doesn't matter what it is, plumbing or history, they're all the same, but who has learnt values as a result of doing so. We don't teach people to concentrate enough. There's too much smattering of just knowledge, which is of no importance at all compared with wisdom. But I think the most important thing to teach a child, and something which never seems to be taught now at all, is to make every individual realize, every child realize, that he or she, in a world where you're governed by forces you can do nothing about at all, the ceiling may fall on one at any moment, you can't alter these things. But what you can alter, and what the Creator has given us the power to alter, is how we take all the things that happen in our life, that freedom of choice. And all the time, throughout his life, as I see it, an individual is having to make choices, choices on which the development of his own character depends.
You've got to be confident to be able to take a choice in anything, though, haven't you?
I think that is where faith is so important. I was very fortunate. I'm not a religious man. I seldom go to church. I simply cannot stand what they've done to the liturgy and the authorized version of the Bible. But I my parents gave me a faith in the future, in a world after this world. I can't define it, but I've never fortunately lost that faith, and that gives one hope all the time.
You've been so taken up by England's past. What is it that worries you about its future?
I'm not worried about its ultimate future. I share that faith that William Pitt, in the year 1797, when the industrial districts, the whole of Europe was aligned against us under a great revolutionary force, when the industrial districts were starving, the city was on the point of bankruptcy, Ireland on the verge of rebellion, and then even the fleet mutinied, or part of the fleet mutinied. And in a speech in the House, William Pitt said, "I am not afraid for England. We shall stand to the day of judgment." And if you could put money on something in 100 years' time, I would certainly put my money on England. I think climatically we are probably the most fortunate place in the world. Our climate is just right.